myself and Len Metcalf have been talking online for over a year now, but obviously never met up because I think we're about as far as apart as each other as photographers can get. Len's come up to our house 2 weeks ago, week and a half ago, for a 36-hour flight. And we spent the last week wandering around the Lake District. And as I said earlier, Len's bought a bunch of prints, and you've seen a few of them upstairs. And they speak to me. One of the things I was quite interested in about your work is how you develop a consistent visual look. And every single one of your pictures fits in a series, in a style that's quite strong. And it's one of the conversations we've been having in the workshop for the last week with our clients. Everybody asks, how do I get a style? How do I get a look? And we're trying to tell people, and it's probably a theme throughout the conference, that it's about photographing things that mean something to you. And if you can do that, everybody has a different point of view about what means something to you. So Len's going to talk about punctuation and simplicity. So I'll let you take it away.
Oh, thank you very much, Tim. I must start with thanking Tim. It's been such a pleasure to actually arrive here and feel so welcomed by yourself, to make such good, solid friendships, and to be welcomed by all the people that I meet. I actually feel like a guest and at home at the same time, and it's absolutely wonderful. As far as style goes, I also agree with Tim in that I tell people very strongly that I don't chase my own style. I wait for someone else to tell me what it is. I just chase things that are important to me. And the space between things is very, very important to me. So today's talk is about the space between. So I thought I'd better show you that particular photograph before, in its full glory. Big, wide, open spaces. Now, that's down at Stack Island at the Minamara River on the coast of the east coast of Australia, a beautiful place. Punctuation is the system of signs and symbols given to a reader to show how a sentence is constructed and how it should be read, said Google, apparently. Makes me think very much about the space between the trees, what it does to the trees. While I'm photographing this, I'm spending as much time thinking about that space between the trees as the trees themselves. This photograph is quite important because it was a few minutes after I was working with one of my wonderful students, Kel, and he asked me about complex negative space. And he termed a whole new coin for me. And this photograph actually anchors that moment. This is down in Kangaroo Valley, a beautiful place. So this talks about thinking about visual pauses, stopping between photographs. What things stop us? Now, this one looks quite complex. And in one way of looking at it, it's a series of lines, beautiful lines, the trees, the horizontals, the verticals, the repeating diagonals. The mess behind of the ferns and the branches, to me, reinforce and punctuate those lines. This is a dip creek in the Tarkine in Tasmania. A beautiful spot. 3 metres of rain every year. Here you can see I'm really exploring the space between the trees. The water and the movement in the water really becomes the subject. The trees punctuate the blank space. So in my research about this space between, I came across a thing called ma, which is a Japanese word which can roughly be translated as gap, space, pause, or the space between two structural parts. Now, we know with other words like notan, wabi-sabi, that the English translation can be quite lost, and I'm sure that it's much more complicated than this simple... what's it called? Definition says. So I'm sure it's much more complicated. But let's duck into this particular photograph. For me, this is the S of the water, in the soft water, rather than the rocks. And I got so excited at this particular spot. This is at the edge of the world, the most western point of Tasmania. Out there shooting late at night with a client group. It was windy and rainy, and the light was just becoming really good. And I noticed that a fair few of them were gathering at the car and they wanted me to go. And unfortunately, I have to chase the clients and wander off with them. But notice very much so the S, the soft water. Now, this is probably... the same view, but a slightly different take on it. And I've opened up the rocks much more clearly. And now we're actually having a balance between the negative space and the rocks are becoming much more the subject. I haven't really quite decided which one I like yet, but that's to illustrate what really excites me. So if I just go back, it's really that beautiful S curve in that open, big open space. So Mozart said at one point that he wasn't so much interested in the notes as in the space between them. And I've got this quote from Hayley Parker. You'll often see this quote as quoted as Mozart, but in my checking I found out that there's no actual real reference to him. And I'm not even sure why Hayley Parker can claim that he actually said this thing, but it's widely publicised as one of those things. I love learning and concentrating and thinking about photography from a musician's perspective. One of my articles on landscape was listening to musicians talk about their creative process, and I'm sitting in the audience going, oh my God, that's exactly what I do in my photography. The space between the notes. So here we are at Tim's new place up in Scotland. In my I think it was a 12 or 13 hour visit, I got whisked up there. The gaps between these two trees. Someone the other day quickly pointed out that it's a negative space Christmas tree up in there. Here I am down in the Great Ocean Road in Australia, down in Victoria, again on a workshop. The shape of that white space is what totally intrigues me, what gets my blood boiling and what excites me. The edges just become the topping, the extra spice that gives the photograph a bit of life. So this is something that I've worked out that is important to me. And so I've kept going with my research and started to find out a few more things. And I discovered that engineers call the gap between things signal to noise ratio. So here we are, I'm down in Naruma, playing with Hiroshi Sugimoto's idea of the horizon in the middle of the photograph. I got a bit tired of my camera taking so long to do the dark frame subtraction. I turned it off, and unbeknownst to me that the noise was going to be so bad. I think this was a 5-minute exposure. But it still speaks to me, even though the signal to noise ratio is really quite tiny, I think you'd say, or is it high? I have no idea, as not being a scientist, how they would describe it. But the gap And the noise in there adds beautiful grain, and something can sort of be pulled out from something quite complex. The leaves of these beautiful little plants dominate most of the photograph. They form the backdrop. And then as I look at it, my eyes get drawn into the drops of water. And then finally, and our brains are very, very good at this, we start to pick out the little lines of grass. And that is what caught my attention. Their shape, where they're pointing, how they're constrained. Quite a noisy photograph, I think. And here I am on the Pyman River in Tasmania, deep in the Tarkine, a couple of kilometres up from the coast, looking out over Dawn. And this is to illustrate that I don't really need very much between the tones to pull out something that works. In terms of signal to noise, we've got a very, very, very flat, tiny photograph, and yet something happens there. This is one of those photographs that I looked at, I liked, I put it aside, I looked at it again, I started to fall in love with it. I printed it out, put it on the wall, kept coming back. It's still there, which means I must still like it. So it grows on me. So it's the silence between the notes that makes the music. Oh, lost one there. Figure ground. Edgar Rubin in 1915 started exploring the idea. The word Gestalt means whole or form in German. We tend to simplify it by separating the figure from the ground. So in this case, the tree is the figure, and the sky and the grass becomes the ground. Here we are in Hopewell. This is one of those photographs that once I found this tree and I explored it and really photographed it, founding these lovely light lacy leaves, I got so excited I couldn't take another good photo for the rest of the day. Everything else just seemed to pale in insignificance. And I'm afraid that emotion still carries with me today as I look at this photo, and I really can't judge its quality. For me, it's just beautiful because I really hit a moment of high when I actually took this particular photo. But the main point of our talk is to come back to punctuation. The background really punctuates the leaves, and I'm working really, really hard at the space around the leaves to make them really sing. I'm looking for balance at the top, balance underneath them, balance on the right-hand side. It's a real mistake for me when I just consider the figure. This is another one of my favourite photographs. I really struggle with figuring out whether the rocks are the figure or the water is the figure. I think I've settled on the rocks being the figure and the water and the sky being the ground because of the high key moment of them. As you look at it, you'll start to notice that it's really hard to see both at the same time. We tend to switch from one and then switch to the other. And in Gestalt, when we talk about figure ground, that's one of the things that happens. We concentrate on one, then we switch over and concentrate on the other. This is near the Boneyard in Kiama Downs. one of the things that helps with figure ground is colour contrast. So I just slipped this little photograph of a fagus in. Australia only has three or four deciduous trees, and our Arctic beech is one of them. And I've tried to hit Tasmania a couple of times to catch the turn of these leaves, and unfortunately, every year they change on a different date and fall very quickly. So colour contrast can be a fantastic thing to play with figure ground. Obviously the leaf is the figure, and the green moss in the background is the ground. Another one we can play with is high contrast. So this beautiful orchid down in the Snowy Mountains near Jindabyne, just the contrast in the tones enhances the figure. The white area is the ground and the flower is the figure. High contrast increases the figure-ground relationship. Here we have a waratah. These are a beautiful, beautiful red, rich red flower. They're quite large, the size of my hands there. They dot the hill. They really love north-facing ironstone ridges to grow on. And they love to pop up the season straight after a bushfire has gone through. Now, in my processing, I've just dropped the reds to white and dropped the greens through to black to create a tonal contrast, making it very, very clear that the flower is the figure and the leaves are the ground. As you look at it, notice how hard it is to even notice the background. We can't quite get to it. Another way to play with figure ground is focus. Here I am wide open with my Voigtlander lens, 0.95. Creates a bit of a halo, which is looks a bit like subject movement, but it's actually the lens. This is a donkey-eared orchid. I was driving down the road. This is a very tiny orchid. It's only about an inch across, bright yellow. And I spotted one out the window of the car. Had to drive around the block, come back and park and run down and lie beside the road to photograph this. I lay there for half an hour playing with this particular orchid, trying to get something right. Coming back to my obsession, it's not just the flower, but it's the background. When I take a photo of a flower, I like to think of it as a portrait. And as a good portrait photographer, I often start with the background rather than with the subject. I start with the ground and make sure that it's holding the flower beautifully. Then I worry about the angle and then getting the composition just right. This mountain devil, this is another bright red flower that I've brought up to white, and I've darkened the greens in my conversion. The flower definitely becomes the figure, and the background becomes the ground. Now, when we have a large object in our photograph, as in this tree, notice how hard it is to get to the background. We keep coming back visually to the figure. Like, it would be really nice to wander up that ridge there in Cradle Mountain in Tasmania, but visually I get sucked back to the tree. That's what tends to happen when we really work on things that have a strong figure-ground relationship. Here I am in Broken Hill. I'm going the other way now, from something very, very large to something very small. and yet it clearly becomes the subject again. I spent a fair bit of time trying to position myself to get this tree. There's this, my self-critiquing part of me keeps coming back and going, it's still not quite right. There was a spot that I really wanted to get to make the hill really round, but there was a bit of a cliff there, so I couldn't get there. So the big open space, the lonely tree, the huge hill, the figure ground works incredibly well for me, and that's part of my obsession. I like to play with this notion of figure ground and not use it as a rule book, but just as an idea to play with. Here, I wonder whether the grass is the subject and the figure, or it's the tree. And which one becomes the ground to the other? You can see that this particular lens gets a little bit nervous at that aperture. I don't know that this particular photograph will make it to print. And today I'm going to show you photographs from my back catalogue, I suppose, that I don't show in exhibitions, but I'm showing them to illustrate some of the points and to bare my soul to you, so you can see what goes on behind the scenes. That's in the Flinders Ranges. This backlit king fern is in a canyon. My friends dubbed this canyon Kissing Canyon. This is in the Walgan Valley in the Blue Mountains where I live. The size of the fern and the background are really important when we start playing with figure ground. When I'm taking a photograph like this, I have to actually switch from the subject to the background, play with the space, how much space around it, where does the balance fit, then switch back to the tree to make sure that I've got it right, that it stopped in the wind at the time of pressing the shutter. Here we have ambiguous figure ground. The size and the shape of the beautiful leaf are somewhat equal to the stones on the beach around there. I've noticed that this photograph needs a little bit of size to really shine. When I print it a little bit small, in my usual 7-inch size, it gets a little bit lost and needs a little bit of size to it. This was taken on a workshop I attended. Every year I take myself off and choose a photographer that inspires me, and I spend some time with them to put myself back in the seat of being a student, to remind myself what it's like and to get some ideas for teaching. Freeman Patterson here, down in the northern end of the South Island of New Zealand, sat me down on a log and made me sit there for an hour. And I wasn't to take a photograph. I was to write in my journal. After the hour, I was allowed to sit there for another 2 hours without moving to take photographs. Now, this particular leaf was something that I found. I picked it up, I cleaned it, and I started to photograph it in my hand. I couldn't get anything too exciting, so I just let it go in the wind and started concentrating on other things. And an hour later, I noticed it on the ground. And that's when I captured this particular photograph. So I didn't place it there, but I did have a very direct hand in where it ended up. Absolutely fantastic exercise. The writing forces me to clear my head. It was really interesting to notice that the ideas that I had in my writing about which photographs I was going to take didn't eventuate. when I actually picked up the camera, I had a really clean, clear head and was able to work. And I didn't take the ones that I thought I wanted to take when I was sitting there looking. And I'm still processing and figuring out what actually happened there. So, ambiguous figure ground, and it's worth playing with and lots of fun. So here we are at the edge of the world, and it is called that, over in the west coast of Tasmania in the Tyne, which is the most beautiful, pristine wilderness. And it's a conservation battle that we haven't won yet and that we're still going into fight. And you'll hear, hopefully, a bit more about that next year when the conservation movements actually start again. There's some mines in the area, and the government has very carefully called the area a wilderness area, but they haven't actually designated it a wilderness area, and they've only made the edge of the area a national park, and the whole middle part of it is left for logging and mining, so that'll come up. You'll notice that the object being up really high in the ground causes a sense of uneasiness, that it's going to tumble down. And what really makes the this photograph for me is the beautiful patterns in the sand and how they flow around the rock. The ground is so important in this that it actually reverses in my mind. I actually find the sand being the figure and the rock being the ground in terms of importance in the composition for me as I'm actually thinking about it. So Gestalt has quite a lot of wonderful things for us photographers, and it's really worth exploring it further. But it's not being the subject of this talk to go down that line. So I'd like to take you a bit into positive and negative space. And this is really where I started. And I know this isn't a landscape photograph, but this is taken in the most beautiful landscape. This is in Cradle Mountain in Tasmania. It was raining outside and we've got lovely soft light coming through the window, and I'm in there playing with the chair while everyone's wandering around taking photographs. At art school, when we're taught to draw, or when I'm an art teacher and when I teach people to draw, we actually turn the chair upside down and put it in the middle of the classroom. And we ask our students to draw the spaces between the chair. And what happens is when we look at it upside down, we stop thinking that a chair has a seat, four legs, and a back. We start to actually look at the shapes. There's some triangular shapes, there's some rhombuses, there's some circular sort of shapes, there's some straight lines, there's some diagonals. And then we would go into tone and start playing with the tone. Now, I'm lucky that I spent 20 years chasing the country with a large format photographer, with a large format camera, being a large format photographer, totally obsessed with people like Peter Dombrovskis as one of my heroes. And this is how we compose. We start this way once we get under our dark cloth into our camera. Now, we actually start a step before that, obviously, but once we're actually framing and we're fine-tuning, we're working upside down. And obviously, it's been discussed many times by some of the people in this room how wonderful it is to work upside down. And it's because we switch off what our brain is telling us about the spaces and the shapes. And then we can swing it around. And then this is the final photograph. With practice, you can switch and start concentrating on the negative space. So here I am in Tasmania. Oh, no, not Tasmania. The Flinders Ranges. I'm at the Cazano tree, which is a very famous Australian photograph called the Spirit of Endurance, shortened to Endurance these days. And there's a car park and a sign that says, take your photograph here. You walk along the track, and under a beautiful tree, there's actually a plaque with the photograph and tells you where to stand to take the photograph of this beautiful tree that was photographed probably about 80 or 100 years ago. And in my usual technique of trying not to take, and I'll quote Mark John here, Mark Little John, the honeypot shot, he calls it, I'm looking around to find something different. And this is the tree that I'm standing under. And a very simple silhouette, and I'm really quite excited by this dead branch that's coming down from the gum tree. Then I switch into the negative space and start composing around it. And for me, this is one of my magic shots of the Flinders Ranges, and this just rings so strongly of that area. And this is my spirit of endurance. This is taken in the Blue Mountains where I live. This is about a 10-minute walk from my home. This is a place that is one of the most popular visited places for short walks in the mountains. The walk is probably only a quarter of a mile long. It wanders down via a most beautiful waterfall that's photographed to death. When I was a child growing up there, there was actually lights on it at night, and it was the most magical place, but they've all sort of fallen apart and don't work anymore. This particular photograph reminds me that when I visit an area over and over again, there's more work to be found there. So I've wandered up and down this waterfall with my clients lots and lots of times. They're all concentrating on the waterfalls, and I'm looking around for things that I haven't seen yet. The negative space between the lines of these tree reinforces the tree. So I'm actually composing there a negative space of triangles, which mirror the triangles in the trees. This is one of those photographs that when I got at home, I got very, very excited by it. Not a photograph I would have taken 20 years ago. I would have thought it was too messy and too complex. But as I get older, I'm really starting to celebrate the mess in nature, the chaos in nature, and pursue it. Now, this particular photograph was taken in Cradle Mountain, and I was showing it at a camera club on a talk about digital black and white photography. And a gentleman in the back piped up and said, hey, Len, I think it'd be a lot stronger if you chopped the top off. And unfortunately, I had a bit of a go at him as a guest to the club. And is that the way? I questioned the way that he would treat the other members of the club and their photographs. But I went home and I chopped it off and had a look. And yes, it makes it more impactful, but it loses something for me. And I really started to ponder what was lost. And it really dawned on me that the bit that I was chopping off was really taking away from the photo, and that the square photo really wasn't right. So I went back to the original, which is this one. And when I was taking it, I had a very, very deep sense of pain because I was standing there looking across a large area of dead trees. And we call it dieback in Australia, where a whole set of trees go In this case, we don't really know, or haven't been able to find out what caused the dieback. Sometimes it's a shift in the water table. Sometimes it's the climate. Sometimes it's a fire going through. In some areas of Australia, the trees regenerate when a fire comes through. In other places, they just die. I was feeling sad for this tree, and the heavy weight of the big space above was really, really important to me. This has become one of those photographs that has reminded me that I need to get my cropping right in camera. If I go back to the square one, I think if I'd taken this one in square at the time, the tree would be a lot smaller and there'd be a lot more sky in that photograph. I'd trimmed it to make it square, to make it fit with my other photographs, and I think that's where I fell short of my original vision. I won't buy a camera unless it can shoot square. And I think I lost square. I was started on a square camera. I went to 35 for about 10 years, and then I went back to a square camera for about 2 years. And then when I discovered large format, I went 5:4 in that aspect ratio for a long period of time. And then when a digital camera turned up that I could actually set to square again, fell into my hands, I won it in a competition, and I actually set it to square and started working, I suddenly felt like I was at home. And I haven't really left that shape ever since. So it's not what you look at that matters, it's what you see, is what Thoreau said. So as you can see, I love playing with the big space around. I get so excited when the mist comes in. The one weather that we haven't yet had in my short stay here in the Lake District is really thick mist, so I'm excited when that comes in while I'm here. This is Lake Eucombine down in Jindabyne. This is a snow gum in the Snowy Mountains. These are beautiful trees. They glow green. They have pink, green, orange, yellow, even blue hues in the bark, all in the same tree. Absolutely stunning. They give this beautiful lines through them. They're gnarled and bent and short and stout because of the snow that comes in and the wind blows them around. Now, when I'm composing this, I'm thinking very heavily about the white shapes. And I want them to balance. So not only am I looking at the beautiful tree and the lines and the shapes of the tree, I'm switching off for a few minutes and really concentrating on the whites. And I'm trying to find balance in those whites. This is a grab shot. We arrived, this is on the Nunes Plateau in the Blue Mountains, close to where I live, maybe half an hour's drive. It was a pine forest, a plantation pine forest. And on this particular day, we were driving out to look at the glowworm tunnel area. And we came around the bend, the mist was really thick and really set in. Technically, it was probably a fog. We got out. The feeling of desolation just hit me really, really strongly, and I felt so sorry for those trees. Now, I shouldn't feel sorry for a plantation forest, but I still did. This yellow-tail black cockatoo flew past and caught my attention. And I'm just swinging around as it flies past quickly to capture the photo. And unfortunately, We had high ISO and it's quite a noisy photograph. I went to put it in an exhibition and the first print of it was so horrendous I ripped it up. And I was having a bit of whinge on Facebook about it and someone said, Len, why don't you try a little bit harder? It really is a beautiful photograph. And I spent another day and a half going back and playing with different software solutions to try and reduce it to pull out a nice print of it. When I first saw it in the back of the camera, it was one of those moments, oh, I've got something really special. And then later I started to question whether it was any good. And then over time, it kept coming back to me as a moment, a very, very special moment. And not that I had time to think about it as I grabbed it, but the negative space in this photograph really balances out. For me, there's something that really works there. I think I also like it because people tell you you shouldn't put anything straight through the middle of the photograph, and this proves them wrong. Now, the balance in the negative space is really the two areas sort of matching. The balance between the trees also holds the photograph together really well, and the weight of just that tiny little bird helps to balance that tree. I love this shot. And it reminds me of that sad forest. I've been there recently and they still haven't replanted it. And it's in threat of becoming a sand mine. So they've decided that the soil isn't good enough to grow trees again. And that's another little conservation battle that needs to be fought. Here we are again in the Tarkine. You might gather that the Tarkine is one of my favourite places to photograph. With the 3 metres of rain, I can be guaranteed that over my week I'll get some beautiful rain and some lovely soft light to go out and explore. On a simplistic level, we can look at the trees as being the main subject and the lovely curves between them and the balance between all that. But then take a moment and actually look at the negative space. Notice how they balance, how the figures of the tree come away from the background. In this photograph, the negative space is very subtle and less dominant than in some of my work. I love the mess that's in this particular photograph. Here we are on the Fish River, just below Jindabyne, again in the Blue Mountains. This was the first day out with my camera, the digital camera that I could put on square, with a manual focus lens, a fixed prime. I got so excited. And this photograph anchors the switch from turning off autofocus and going to manual focus for me, and going square, and probably going black and white. This really anchored that particular moment for me in my life. The negative space in this particular photograph provides the depth. And like Mark spoke before us, the mist provides an absolute beautiful depth to your photographs. And it's my belief that depth in a photograph helps the viewer spend time in there. I could easily wander through those trees out into the background and into the depth. So music is the silence between the notes. This is Philosopher's Fall Reserve in the Tarkine. The shapes, again, are what's really attracting me compositionally. After I get past the dark lines, and finding that balance. When you first get there, the density and the thickness of the bush is so strong that it overwhelms you, and trying to find sense of it is quite hard. One of the things that I love exploring as well is chiaroscuro, so the depth, the roundness of the tree caused by the deep tones and then the light tones behind. This is 5 minutes walk from my home. We live on the top of the mountain, and all our bushwalks, we drop down into the valley below. We walk around the valley and then have to walk back up the hill at the end of the day. You all get to walk up the hill at the beginning of the day and then walk down at the end of the day. It's quite a different feeling walking down into the valley. Here you can see the joy and the sense of mist playing in the mist, the shape and the dances of the mist amongst the trees has really caught my attention. Tim might have mentioned much earlier this morning that I'm a one-lens sort of photographer. I do carry a bag of lenses. There's one in there I don't think I've used for 4 years. There's one I use maybe once a day, and then I tend to leave my standard lens on for the whole day. I shoot with a nifty 50. For 98% of my work, and occasionally I'll switch out of it, and if I'm ever starting to feel lost, I'll put it back on again and I feel at home. And that has really helped my photography, and I really need to take the next step and take those other lenses out of my bag. I sort of still hang on to a bit of security in there with them, but I don't really need them or use them. I think I've got a fish eye that I've used once. Just doesn't seem to suit me, that big wide view. It means that I come across a lot of photographs in my mind that I can take that I don't really take with the camera, so I'm left with them as beautiful images in my head. Getting rid of choice makes my life easier and makes my creativity stronger. This is at Meyer Lakes at Mungo Brush. I like to call this photograph a bit of a snap. It probably isn't. I probably put as much effort into it as I would normally. I think I just wasn't in that total concentration photographic mode that I get at the time that I took this photograph. It's one that jumped back out of me much later and said, "Hey, look at me. I'm really quite an exciting, beautiful photograph, one that I'd like to share the world with." And the round shape in the middle that's held by those bushes, the curve of the beach that goes around, really epitomises that joy of photographing the space, the bits between things, using the trees and the sand just as a little bit of extra spice around the edges. Now, in my search about the space between, I came across this particular quote. "The space between, the idea is that when you make space, you take a break, slow down, and magic can happen." Now, this is a bit of a jump, but it is the title of my talk, so I thought it was very important to play with. I really think that this really works with our photography. I love to go somewhere and just sit, let the place come to me, let the photographs come. The longer that I spend in a place, the easier the photographs come. The slower I walk, the more the photographs come. Magic happens. Now, I want to share with you a series of photographs where I'm playing with space. I haven't really decided with any of these are any good yet, so this is sort of a sneak peek into my catalogue. but I thought it'd be really nice to illustrate what I'm talking about. So here I am on the Great Ocean Road, and a bit of big rock in the foreground. I'm just trying to put a bit of a triangle there to create a bit of movement in my photograph. Take a photograph. I step back a bit further, put some of these bushes in. These are a beautiful turquoise colour. And then start expanding that space in the middle of the water. And I get this particular photograph. I suddenly become excited by that rock in the middle. And then I go closer. Closer to the edge. Pulling out even more negative space and playing with that rock and the waves crashing over it, making waterfalls as they fall down. You can notice that each of these, the background, the rocks across the back, the big cliffs, hardly change. I pull back some more, and to be smart, I try and put something down in that little corner. It reminds me of a photograph I was turning into a photogravure through an etching process. And I'd done the same thing with a leaf down the bottom. And my teacher said to me, "Oh, Len, I really think you should Photoshop that out." And I'm like, "Do you know how hard I worked to put it there?" I put that there. And then I thought I'd try one without. I still haven't decided which one of those set that I really like. But as I'm playing and experimenting, suddenly the magic happens and we get a rainbow. I haven't quite decided whether this fits in with my work or not, but something definitely happened at that moment. Something very, very beautiful. So it's the space between that punctuates the image. Visual punctuation. This is Boar's Head. Boar's Head is that little rock in the top left-hand corner. The mouth is roaring. The mist is rising. I'm at the edge of a big cliff looking down. Totally excited by the rush of wind and the cold air that's lifting from the valley and blowing into my face. Absolute beautiful place to be. This is a few weeks ago, and this is walking down Fuba Steps down into Echo Point. We're looking across here to Echo Point. The three sisters are sort of in the mist on the other side. These cliffs are huge. We're looking at 100, 150 metre cliffs. When I was young, I wanted to climb them, and I did spend a lot of time climbing this area. Now it's my photographic joy to be in there, working in the mist. The three sisters have finally started to creep into my photographs. I lived in the Blue Mountains for 15 years, and I didn't want to go and stand at Echo Point and take a photograph like the 5,000, 10,000 people that visit on a daily basis to the one lookout. I wanted to find something unique. And I did three shots of the three sisters over those 15 years, and I tried to get myself into positions that other people couldn't get to. Trying to smart myself into taking a very different photograph. So I climbed down from another point on the other side until I was halfway down the cliff to take one photograph, and I stayed there till sunset, and that was a failure. I tried another one from the valley floor looking up through the trees, and that was a failure. And this one is really special to me because it came on the very last day that I went to work for TAFE, which is a vocational training organisation, where I worked and trained outdoor guides in the Blue Mountains, on my way to work. I'd been sleeping in my car. I was living in Sydney and I'd go up to work for 3 days a week and sleep in my car in the Blue Mountains. And I'd been sleeping out a narrow neck, and that morning I'd got up and there was a lyrebird that I encountered. And they're the most beautiful creatures. They imitate other birds and sing and dance. And so in my morning photographic walk, I was quite blessed to have 15 minutes of lyrebirds singing to me. So I hopped in my car and drove around the corner, and this was presented to me. So I pulled over, grabbed the camera, ran down to a lookout, not the main lookout, set my focus as I was running down, set my aperture and quickly grabbed a grab shot, and then took a big deep breath and then took a few more and made sure I had everything right. And this really anchors that last day at work for me. And it's my take on trying to find a different view and something rather different of a photograph, of a icon that was chosen for marketing purposes, I must admit, to promote the Blue Mountains. And it's photographed to death. So 15 years, and one day when I, by chance, I was driving past on just the right day. Lucky I went to work that day. Actually, I didn't go to work. I drove around the car park a few times and said, that's it, I'm leaving. Parked the car, ran into the big bosses and said, right, I want out. And that was it. Never went back. Now, here we are at Dip Falls in Tasmania, in the Tarkine. Obviously, I'm playing with the beautiful diagonal line of this log. There's another little bit of gestalt there. Our eye continues the log into the water, even though we can't really see that it does. When I first looked at this photograph, I was actually disappointed about the blur in the man fern, they're called down there, down in the bottom left-hand corner. But it's grown on me, and grown and grown and grown. And the balance in the big open spaces really punctuates the beautiful lines and shapes of the plant that's almost reaching around to grab that log. So vision is the art of seeing what is invisible to others. So I think I'll finish on this slide, which brings me up to time, I think. Here we are in Chinaman's Well in Lake Mungo in Central Australia, playing with the sand dunes. I love shooting a small format camera because I don't have to worry about tilts and swings to get my depth and field. I can just stop it down and shoot away. Haven't quite figured out what the negative and positive space is. Haven't quite figured out what the figure and the ground is. I'm just loving the patterns of the wind-blown sand as it blows across and disappears off into the distance. And on that note, I'd like to thank you for listening, and I look forward to talking to you over the rest of the conference. Thank you.
So Len, firstly, thank you very much for the talk. It's really a pleasure to see how you approach things like gestalt, figure ground, and illustrate it with some astonishing pictures, really beautiful pictures.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah. As a photographer, how long did it, you come from an art school? Background, is that
an
correct?
Art, yes, an art school. I actually went to learn to draw and paint, and I didn't really fit in with the methodology or the it was called the art on the paint on the floor school at the time, and I wanted a real classical education on how to draw and how to paint, and I didn't get it. and I wanted to paint and draw trees and landscapes, and I was doing virtually botanical illustrations.
Yes.
And the photography teachers loved what I was doing and encouraged me and supported me. So I ended up coming out with a major in photography.
Yeah.
And I went in to learn to draw.
So do you think the art teachers were helping you in the understanding of the composition techniques and the formal?
No, not at all.
Yeah. They expected you to just breathe that in.
Yes.
To arrive.
Yes, that was just had to turn up on its own.
Yeah.
And I don't think I started understanding about light and chasing light till 20 years later. Didn't occur to me at that age. I was trying to do work like other people, but I didn't understand what was actually happening. And very good teachers, if I encountered a problem, they'd counter it back with a question and then send me off on a research project. So I've become very, very good at researching and solving my own problems. And that's been a fantastic process to take on.
This was at art school.
Yeah, art school. Yeah. So through time, I've developed my own work and figured out composition, how it works for me.
So you ask yourself questions and, and discover them.
Yes, and then look at people's work and try and figure out why it works and how it works.
A lot of people ask about, when you talk about composition, not necessarily you, but anybody talks about composition, they often have a feeling that all this is going on consciously, top-level mind, while you're looking at a photograph. How much is it conscious and how much of it is it an instinctive recognition?
I think overall composition is a very subconscious thing. I think we refer to a visual bank of photographs that we have and art that we have. The more I consume of great art, that seems to come back in my work in its own way, but understanding how great works work. But and that all happens on an unconscious level, I think. I don't stand there and go, I'm going to think of Turner as I'm taking this particular photograph, or Peter Dombrovskis or someone like that. But what I do stand there and think about is, once I'm honing in on what it is have I got everything right that I need to have right? I'm running my eye around the edges, checking the edges. I'm checking my exposure, my focus, doing all the technical things, and letting the composition come through emotionally, because it's the my best work is a really solid emotional response to a place.
So do you think a lot of the composition that you've talked about here is something that you've programmed yourself by researching, by looking at the pictures, by analysing your own pictures, but once you're out it becomes more subconscious?
Yes, very much so. And as a photography teacher, I have to verbalise it to help people learn. So I'm always talking about composition and teaching composition. That lovely Picasso saying, learn all the rules like a pro and then break them all like an artist. And that's really true. You have to explore them to figure them out and then work out what they mean and then throw them all away and then go from the heart. So it's a long, slow process to get to that moment of where it's just coming straight out of you, I think. That's how it has been for me.
And you learned photography at your art school in the 1980s, 90s?
Yeah.
Yeah. Who
80s,
else?
Mid-80s I started at art school.
Who was around in Australia producing photography? We talk about Peter Dombrovskis, who was a...
Well, he was my hero at that time. I used to hound my mother from the age of 15 to buy his calendars and diaries, and I have every one of his diaries from that age group until he stopped producing them. And they're actually my working diaries, so we can flick back to such and such a date and see what was actually doing. And I'd spend hours looking at his work, and I really wanted to pursue that in that way. So once I discovered a large format camera, I started working vertically. I started working in the landscape. I started working with transparency film. And that was a very passionate thing to pursue at that time.
So that was a path of having your own guide for a while before you found something of your own.
Yeah, but a fascinating thing happened, Tim, is that the day I graduated from art school, I had straight distinctions in photography. I won the best photographer of official title of my award was Most Advanced Colour Photographer. Fuji was to sponsor me. A camera shop was to sponsor me. I was being given tripods and gear, and I turned around and walked away. And I put down my camera for 15 years, and I didn't take a photograph in that time. And I pursued a much more direct approach to environmentalism. Like, environmentalism was a very, very strong driving force, and I felt that photography of beautiful places was preaching to the converted. So I actually went and started working with kids very directly about teaching them environmental values, and then that led to a career in education. And it wasn't till 15 years later that I picked up a camera, started a project, and went, oh my God, I've forgotten what this was like. And from that day since, it's been obsessive. Very, very obsessive, which has been fantastic.
Yeah. And you're quite a broad range photographer, and it's not just landscape. You've got passionate in figure photography, new photography, city photography. You've got a passion for the camera, but you've always worked as an outdoor person. You were a leader in the outdoors.
Yeah, I was an outdoor guide. I taught cross-country skiing. I used to take people ski touring. I worked taking people bushwalking and caving and rock climbing. I was a rock climbing instructor. I was working on very early outdoor experiential corporate training programs. That became a bit of a career for a while. I ended up running my own business for a while. And at that time, I got a taste for teaching people to teach. And that became my second career, which was how to teach. And that culminated in lecturing in adult education for a university. And then that led to the photography starting again.
Yeah.
And the really fascinating thing about that is that my photography was better the day that I picked up the camera. Like, it was better than the day I put it down. So that 15 years of life experience just helped my work beautifully. And it wasn't years of practice. Something else happened there. And maybe I grew up, or maybe I grew old, or maybe I grew jaded.
You've seen more
it changed.
And lived more.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. And that was a ring with what Mark was saying, as an older person having finished their career as a police person and then starting photography. And, right, his whole life comes through his work.
Yeah.
Well, beautiful.
What are your end goals for your photography? We've talked about a few exhibitions that you've had.
Well,
is the experience of photography almost more important than the end product for you?
In some ways, yes. I hate post-processing. I hate sitting at the computer. I love exhibitions and exhibiting my work, but I have to force myself to do it. Like, I'll book a show, and then I won't actually worry about what's going into it until the last minute, and then I'll print it, get it in, and finish it. I think the thing that's coming is books. I was talking to John Blakemore last night and talking about books, and then I'm starting to tell people that I've really got to take that step. I've already handmade one book, and that was an art school project. That was a very, very beautiful book, and that was a major work. And it's fallen apart because I didn't really know what I was doing. But it's a start, and then I've got that little barrier, and I just have to step through it and get going in the next little bit. And so I think you'll see some books coming up, and I'm probably starting with handmade ones. I'm not talking mass-produced things, things that are very personal and intimate for me.
These are things that force you to look at your work in a different way again.
Yes, and to revisit it.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tim.